Welcome to the Epcot International Festival of the Arts. Whether it's painting, carving, photography, or pancake art, everyone has a creative, artistic side. Get ready to enjoy our next presenter and creative seminar.
Welcome. My name's Doug Griffith. I'm a creative designer with Walt Disney Imagineering. If you may not be familiar with that division of our company, we're the ones that design and build the theme parks, the resorts, and the cruise lines. I'll give you a really quick brief bio of myself so you know where I'm coming from. I first started with Walt Disney Imagineering, which was then called Wet Enterprises, back in 1981. I was a character animation student at the California Institute of the Arts, and at the time they were building both Epcot Center and Tokyo Disneyland and needed more animators. So they came to the school and gave some of us job offers, and I kind of jumped at the chance. Had the opportunity to do the Kitchen Cabaret, the original Journey into Imagination, and a year later, Horizon. So it was a great time. After that, I left the company for a few years, worked very, very briefly for Don Bluth Productions in film animation, and then moved back east and worked as a product designer for a while. 1987, I got the call to come back, and that was to start. That's when we were going to the studios, and that was for the Great Movie Ride, and I've been with the company ever since. It's been quite a wild ride. A lot of things happening in between there, which I don't have time to talk about, but what I am excited about talking with you about today is something I don't often have the chance to do. I do a lot of internal education for the company, for WDI on animation. Rarely have the chance to talk about this stuff in public, especially the fundamentals. And since this is an arts festival, I want to really focus on the fundamentals of the art of audio animatronic animation. It's a bit of a mouthful if you try to say it too fast. But I want to break it down to eight principles. There's more, of course, but not that will fit in a half an hour presentation. These are things that I found through the years are really essential to being successful. You know, and you don't need a multi-million dollar robot to use these things. If you're into puppeteering, if you're into just messing around with any type of animation, all this applies. So maybe you can, you know, if you're into that stuff, you have some takeaways today from this. So we'll get right to it. Principle one, remember that you're creating an illusion. And this is really difficult sometimes because in an art form where the end product is actually a machine, there's a lot, you know, it's seen as technical a lot of the time, and the art sometimes seems to kind of fade away. So Mark Davis, he really nailed this whole concept of illusion. He, of course, you know, was one of the nine old men. He's a Disney legend. Did stuff both in film animation and in, you know, for our parks, designed the pirate ride and Haunted Mansion, and his drawings are kind of legendary. I remember he came to CalArts to lecture. I was there once, and the only thing I remember from the lecture was he told us that we couldn't draw. So he's probably right, but he said this. He said this was rather naive in thinking, because our problem was not to create a mechanical man, but it was really to create an illusion. And I'll show you the clip that comes from here in a second. And that was when they were developing Abe Lincoln for the 1964 World's Fair. And that was really the most complicated human they had done to date. I'm a little bit of a technical issue. Go ahead and run the video.
This was limited in that to the degree that you had characters with their feet nailed to the floor, practically. So you had to figure out something for them to do that was believable. So Walton asked me to give it some thought, and I did a number of things of how simple things work in anatomy, how perhaps a mechanical hand could work. This was rather naive in thinking, because really our problem was not to create a mechanical man, but was rather to create an illusion. Mr. Lincoln would have to rise from a seated position, move one leg forward, and then put himself up into a standing position.
The day finally came for Mr. Lincoln's first performance.
By golly, Mr. Lincoln went all the way through. Matter of fact, we were so successful with this in Illusion that the reviewer, I think, for the New York Times saw it and explained how Mr. Lincoln stood up and walked forward on the stage and gave his address. So the Illusion was pretty good.
And I think that was a great example of what he means by illusion when he used the example of what the reporter said. Because you can do things in your imagination that we can never do in real life. So kind of the task is don't try to replicate everything. Give the audience just enough for them to take it in and do the rest in their own mind. Speaking of that, this kind of flows into the next point. Capturing the imagination. Another Disney legend, Frank Thomas, was a co-author of the book Disney Animation, The Illusion of Life. And it's kind of the Bible for anybody that's in animation, the animation Bible. He said it was in fact that somehow the characters were made to live in the audience's imagination. And he was talking about, you know, really, at the time, you're looking at 24 frames per second, 24 drawings going by, or if it's on twos, maybe 12, or some variant in between. But you're somehow connecting with that, and all it is are lines going by. But you're making it real in your own mind. You're making this character that's being portrayed real in your own mind. Go ahead and run the video.
You know what people say, oh, isn't he cute? Well, that's not the idea of appeal. It's the fact that they're drawn to it. They're fascinated by it. And they might be saying, hey, it reminds you of Uncle Joe's little boy, you know, or the way you were when you were a kid, or I remember doing something like that. They're drawn into it. The more appealing the character is, the more it helps their own self-image as they're into it. Now, it doesn't mean they have to be pretty. It doesn't mean they have to be handsome. They can be a freckle-faced little scrawny kid, but if he's animated with appeal, then you're going to like to look at it.
You know, the thing he's really getting at there is that empathetic response of how we kind of connect with things, and when we do, you know, he mentioned, hey, doesn't it remind you of, you know, Uncle Joe's Little Boy? We all do that. You do it when you read. You know, when you read novels and things, you're providing the imagery to the words from your own experience, and that's something that I've always tried to key in on with this, that if you can get the audience to accept the character, they'll make it their own. But you just kind of can't get in the way. Don't give them too much. Don't overstep your bounds. And I'll talk about that a bit later. Number three, being precedes doing. And that just simply means that you have to, if these things are supposed to be real and they're supposed to have personalities, then we have to look at them, the creators have to look at them as that and not machines. Because you can't expect the audience to believe it's not a machine if you don't. One of the things that we use, character designer and a writer, to try to work through a character is this character profiling. And it's really just an inductive process. It's the who, what, when, where, how, why. This is tailored to kind of what we do, whether it's a theatrical show or a ride-through. It just kind of helps you focus. You know, simple questions like, you know, who's this character remind you of? What are the idiosyncrasies of the character? What's the voice sound like? You know, and then you get into, you know, where is it at? Because we can't just erase lines in what we do. We make machines, and that can be very expensive. So we have to really plan things very much ahead of time to make sure that when we get to the end, we have everything that we're going to need to put that persona, to put that personality, that believability across. Number four, avoid creating false expectations. This is a really tricky one. Anybody here familiar with the theory of the uncanny valley? A few. Basically, the uncanny valley was a theory put forth by a Japanese roboticist, Masahiro Amori was his name, back in 1970. And the theory has been studied, you know, since by different places. The University, or UC San Diego, does a lot of work in this. And they've done stuff since this study, But basically, what his theory was is that when you start to get to a certain point, say he had like a similarity or affinity line here, and this line going this way on a graph was human likeness. And you start with just an industrial robot here, and as you climb, and in his graph he had like a toy robot or a kind of a humanoid robot. At some point, you really get into it, you start having that empathy for it, and then it falls off into the valley. And that's when you start to get so close to the human likeness that something is freaky about it. One of the illustrations that a lot of people that talk about this use, if you're familiar with the movie The Polar Express, which was done a few years ago, it was done when motion capture was just kind of coming on the scene. And some of those characters were, they looked realistic, but they had this glassy stare in their eyes, and their shoulders didn't move quite right. And that's what we all deal with in CG animation and robotic animation. So that's an example of the uncanny valley right there. And then the stuff that we pursue and what I'm involved in is if you take it too far, if you exceed what you can actually do, then you fall into that valley. I feel like I'm living on the edge of the cliff most of the time, you know, day to day. But there's an article, and it's still up on the internet. It's called Your Brain on Androids. And this was an article about some of the research that was done at the Cognitive Science Department at UC San Diego. And Professor Sagan is a quote from her. It says, "The brain doesn't seem tuned to care about either biological appearance or biological motion per se. What it seems to be doing is looking for its expectations to be met, for appearance and motion to be congruent." And they came to that conclusion because they were doing studies putting subjects in front of a human, an android that looked like a human, and then a robot, which was basically the skin stripped off the android. And they had fMRIs going on their brains as they were looking at these things, and it was just a simple movement, like, you know, raise your arm. But they were all doing it, each subject did it. And what they found was the brain was going crazy with the android, because the android looked the most like the human, but didn't move like the human. And that caused the problem. And that kind of gets into this fact of it breaks your ability to kind of have empathy. They said the parts of the brain that, you know, they were watching was the empathetic response part and the monkey see, monkey do part, which is when you're trying to mimic something. You know, so you're trying to look at this thing and you know it's not moving correctly.
Science fiction? No. Behold, the XS Series 1000. The first in a complete line of personal and commercial teleportation systems capable of sending bright-eyed biological life forms like yourselves and even lure life forms like Skippy from one place to another instantly. In a moment, I will break down our fuzzy little friend into a mass of molecules, send those molecules through the air above your head, and reconstruct them in the tube over here as good as new. And now, witness for yourselves the wonders of XS teleportation.
That popped up there before I had a chance to preference it. So no, it's not taking over. This is the uncanny valley flipped on its head. Set up a low expectation. That is a robot, right? Did not move like a robot. So you had a different response, right? Hope you did. You know, it wasn't kind of, might be scary, but in a different way, because he's kind of a sadistic robot. And that was a robot that I had an opportunity to design and animate way back when we had the extraterrestrial alien encounter show in, which Stitch's Great Escape replaced. So it was an interesting study. It came out actually not like I thought it would, because it was not the latest technology. It was kind of a hybrid figure. That figure was actually the old Mr. Johnson figure from the Mission to Mars ride that we repurposed and put some new technology arms on it. But so we do that occasionally. Number five, always move from simple to complex. And this is something that, across all art and across actually all of life, even if you're a writer, you know, like the best pieces, the best writing comes when you can succinctly say something with the least amount of words and get your point across. And simple doesn't always mean simple getting there. A lot of times it's a lot of hard work. But what I want to use to illustrate that is actually this right across the pond here in the American Adventure, the George Washington figure. If you've ever been in the American Adventure, and maybe you can go see it if you haven't, George Washington, he has very little movement. They were using lighting, media, wind on him to kind of put across that that's George at Valley Forge sitting on his horse. And it works beautifully. And it's very, very simple. So go ahead and run that.
This is my fucking bitch. Overindulgent of my Philadelphia's fine woman friend. It is a strange world which you, George Washington, Congress is boring in York.
So we're leaving gaps, right? You don't really see them clearly. You have to fill that in with your own imagination. And that's when you actually become a part of it. This is very close on the heels of what I just showed you, breaking the symmetry of the machine. Inherently, we're working with, you know, plastics and metal, things that, you know, aren't flesh. It can, some of our silicones and materials we use for the skin is, but it doesn't stretch very much. So in traditional animation, you know, one of the first things you learn is how to squash and stretch something. You can do that rather easily with a pencil. You can do it in CG animation really easily. You can't do it here. So what we have to try to do is animate the surfaces that are inherently hard to try to make them look organic. This is going to be a really quick clip of Chief Joseph, again in the same attraction, where we're using light flickering from a campfire to actually animate the surface of his body and his face. And he's draped with a blanket, which we call that free animation. There was one guy who used to work for us who said, nothing's free. But basically, it's when you can apply something that's just gravity will animate it for you. And what it does, it softens the surface, makes it look a bit more like, you know, a human, even though it's still a machine underneath. So go ahead and run that, please.
Honestly, men of my own race treated as outlaws or shot down by cannibals. I hope that all of us may be brothers with one country.
So there you can get a lot of bang for your buck if you just, you know, use costuming effectively. Number seven, I think I have the time to kind of settle on this one for a little bit because this is like super important. The use of juxtaposing and silhouetting for shape. Again, two principles are fundamental to all animation, but we really have to be on it with this because we have very little room for error. This was actually a slide from another lecture that I do internally called Lessons from a Blockhead. It was kind of a theoretical type thing where I was trying to teach how to make something live if it's just all hard surfaces. So we started with, hey, can we make something that would be that you could respond to and relate to if you started with just a block, a green block? And we go through this whole process, and this is about halfway through that presentation. Showing that, okay, you have these surfaces, you're not going to be able to squash and stretch anything, but it's all in the amount, you get the effect all in the way that you move the head against the ribs, against the hips, and how you angle those things, and then what the next keyframe is going to be to come out of that, and how that all plays out. In animation, you know, even any animation, you go with keyframes, right? From one strong move to the next, there's in-betweens in between. But it's all about the keyframes. If you can run through and the figure's just going like this, you know, it's usually how we work. If that looks good, then it's going to look great when the in-betweens are in. So you can see going across from left to right, the figure on the left just has a head turn. And as you move across with the abstracts that I have down below, showing the angles of the head to the ribs, to the hips, and then the wheel down below, you can see that it gets more and more life. And I'm also moving, you know, the eyelids and the eyes and all that also. And on a very basic level, what I'm doing with them is occluding the eyes. We're changing the shape of the whites of the eyes, where in the other types of animation, you might be able to squash and stretch things like that. I'm doing it by hiding it with the lids. And I'll show you a great example of that here next with how we used the principles from this Lessons from a Blockhead just last year when we put a new character in one of our water parks. This is a C principle. Every animator knows this also. This gets into the juxtaposing and the keyframes I just discussed. From one keyframe to the other, if you can make a C one way and then reverse that C, it doesn't have to be broad, it can be in subtle things, it will really read strongly when you're going through an animation sequence. And these are kind of extreme examples of it. This was Duncan the parrot. This was the project that I was referring to just earlier. He is over in Typhoon Lagoon in Misadventure Falls, attraction that we just put in. He's in kind of a shipwreck, a ship haul. The idea of this parrot is he's lost his master, but his master was a treasure hunter, and so was he. He used to dive for treasure, so he's continued to collect treasure. The challenge in this was we could not have any soft surfaces. It's the first figure we ever put into a water park, and Tiki Bird type treatment would not work out there because it's exposed. So the only thing that's even remotely soft on it is a canvas diving suit that he's wearing. So we had to figure out, this was lessons from a blockhead applied. And he had to look, he basically had to do two things. He was a two-trick pony. He had to look through that periscope and then, or telescope and then turn around and talk to his girlfriend behind him. It was kind of like the Tom Hanks Castaway talking to the volleyball thing. So he had to look good in both positions. There's a C principle right there, and that was his main two poses. Head down, head up, and he had a natural curve in the back. So if you go ahead and run that.
Yo ho, yo ho, a pirate's life for me. Holy mackerel, would you look at the flippers on Fox? I like the cut of his jib. Hello, sandals and socks, he wears sandals and socks. Hey, sandals and socks. Sandals and socks, pops with sandals and socks. Watch for 10 lines with sandals and socks. Weird 10 lines.
So that was 11 functions, all hard surfaces. And I don't know if you noticed or not, the eyeballs never move. There's no functions in the eyeballs. The lids move. We link the top lids and the bottom lids separately. Normally we do a clamshell. We broke them up this time so that we could occlude the eye, make different shapes with the whites of the eye. We had a lot of more variables to do that, and that's what gives him his expression in his eyes. The last one, build fences. And what I mean by this is kind of stay on the reservation. I had one of my daughters when she was younger. You know, you tell your kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? And you don't want to limit them. You know, you can be anything. Well, she wanted to be a cheetah. And we had to kind of say, now you can't be a cheetah because you can't change yourself into a cheetah and nobody else can either. So I call that the cheetah principle. And at work sometimes, you can, when we're trying to do difficult stuff, and this actually happened in one of our brainstorming sessions when we were trying to do something extremely technically difficult and we were taking a stab at it. And halfway through, one of the designers said, "Hey, we're Disney, we can do anything." And I said, "But can you pass the cheetah principle?" It's like, so that's what this building fences is all about. You have to know your limitations. And the first thing that you have to know, you're starting with a blank canvas, just like any other artist does. But you have to start putting fences up that you can work within. You have to define the playground that you're working on. So the first thing is a story. That provides the content. It's exactly what are you trying to do, right? What are you trying to say through this figure, through this show? And you just really need to have that down strong. The second is a context. That's the placemaking. So that's the environments that you're going to have to create and how you're going to be presenting this character ultimately, to your audience. What's the duration of that? How long can they see him? That dictates a lot of times how many functions you need, how complex it has to be, how you stage it, how you light it, all that stuff. But it's all in the context of a fence within a fence, then defining the character from that. So, just a couple closing thoughts. You can imagine that, in a company our size and with many disciplines that are involved in putting together the complexity of the stuff that we do, you have artists, you have engineers, you have costumers, cosmetics people, all that have to come together. And something that I've put together in the last couple years to try to get that common thread. You need a common thread. You have so many people touching, the figure that if not everybody is on the same page, then it looks really weird at the end. So this goes almost back to the inductive thing. Just a few questions I ask everybody working on it, to answer. And if everybody's the same answer, it all works. So it's like, who is this character? It is a character. It is a person. You have to believe that. Walt once said when he was describing the Lincoln character for the World's Fair, he said, "Yeah, and go to Illinois, and Mr. Lincoln's going to be there." you know, he didn't say the machine, the audio-animatronic of Mr. Lincoln's going to be there. He said, Mr. Lincoln is going to be there. And that's how the artisans that work on this stuff have to view it. What is this character communicating? It's going to communicate not only, you know, what the track is saying, what the audio is saying, but also in how it's dressed, what the body positioning is, all of that. It's going to be communicating through all those little cues. Where is this character in the scene, the storyline, and in time? So you have to be aware of where it is in the theatrical presentation you're doing, but also, you know, if you have a pirate, you know, that's a grungy old guy that probably hasn't taken a bath in a year, he's not going to have, like, really pressed out, sprayed hair, you know? it's those little things, like, that you really want to emphasize who it is. And then you have to ask yourself, how can I, in what I do as an artisan, you know, contribute to making this character believable? So that's it for the fundamentals of the art of audio animatronics, and thank you.